Welcome, folks. Welcome to a new week. We've got a terrific program for you. We hope you enjoy everything we're going to talk about. I'd love to think the Defense Department is listening to this program, but I'm not sure they are. But nevertheless, they're doing something that we applaud. They have finally gotten some more heavy weapons into those Kurds in Kobani. And we're not sure exactly how much, because it was airdropped in. But nevertheless, the Kurds may need far more to stop that brutal Islamic onslaught.
Well, ISIS now controls about half of Kobani, and the Muslim army desperately wants to capture all of it. Mark Martin has that story.
A spokesman for Kurdish forces says the American airdrop of weapons will help greatly in the battle against ISIS. He says the Syrian Kurds hope for more. The Islamic State militant group currently controls around half of Kobani, which is in a strategic location along the Syrian-Turkish border. The intense battle for Kobani is more important for symbolic reasons than strategic, however. ISIS wants to win a propaganda victory in the midst of U.S.-led airstrikes. Over the weekend, the U.S. used its air power to destroy a Syrian oil refinery held by ISIS. The group's captured oil facilities have netted ISIS as much as $2 million a day. But the attack from the air has now helped push back the Islamic State.
And if he continues to present us with major targets, as he has done in the Kobani area, then clearly we'll service those targets, and we've done so very, very effectively here of late.
U.S. leaders say Kobani could still be lost, but they say the real goal is to degrade ISIS overall and the group's ability to wage war. Meanwhile, the number of refugees left by the jihadist rampage is staggering.
In the nearly 4 years of this crisis, 900,000 people have been registered as refugees here in Turkey. The reality is that the numbers are nearer to 1.6 million.
U.S. leaders say the primary focus is still fighting ISIS in Iraq, but it's clearly trying to stop the Islamic State jihadists from taking Kobani in Syria. If the city falls, it will not only be a strategic and propaganda victory for ISIS, it will be seen in the region as a defeat for the Americans and their allies and become a recruiting tool for ISIS on social media. Mark Martin, CBN News.
Thanks, Mark. Well, here at home, federal officials are getting ready in case they have to deal with more cases of Ebola. Ephraim Graham has that story from our CBN newsroom. Here's Ephraim.
Pat, federal health officials are revising Ebola safety protocols for hospitals across the country. That includes instructions for protective gear to keep the virus from infecting healthcare workers.
One of the things is going to be complete covering with no skin showing whatsoever.
The Pentagon is now assembling a 30-member medical support team to help the CDC fight Ebola if needed. One of the main problems with Ebola is the fact that a person can have the virus inside them but still appear to be in good health. Lori Johnson talked to an infectious disease expert about that problem and a possible vaccine against the deadly virus.
Dr. Nancy Cardori has been studying and treating infectious diseases for the last 30 years. She says one of the main concerns with Ebola is the test. Even if a person is infected with Ebola, the test will be negative until enough of the virus builds up inside the person.
The test becomes positive when they have symptoms. So, you know, it doesn't help you before the symptoms, like many other tests do.
That means people infected with Ebola can enter this country undetected. What happens after that is up to them, but precautions can be taken at the point of entry.
People who are coming from Africa, I'm hoping that this education will happen at the entry level, like at the airports, customs checks, and all say, look, you're coming from XYZ country, and therefore, if you have fever or you just don't feel well, you have a headache, please don't just take your time to go see a healthcare provider. Go quickly.
In an effort to prevent Ebola from spreading in the United States, the CDC has issued a number of guidelines for hospitals across the country. Topping the list, zeroing in on patients who have been to West Africa.
Experts say these patients should be kept and isolated, even if they have symptoms as mild as a low-grade fever. Although Ebola is only spread through direct contact with body fluids, it takes just a drop, splashing into the eyes, nose, even a tiny cut.
if people have a small tear or abrasion that they haven't even noticed, which happens all the time, and they come in contact with somebody's blood or somebody's stool or urine or vomit that has the virus in it, in that case, the virus will go through the skin.
Dr. Carduri says the best hope for containing the spread of Ebola is the vaccine currently in development, which could be given on a mass scale in as early as 6 months.
Because of the technology we have now, that is quite possible, considering and hoping there'll be no hurdles in the process that we don't know of yet.
Dr. Carduri says until Ebola is contained in Africa, it will continue to spread around the world. Lori Johnson, CBN News.
And of course, Pat, many wonder, are we doing enough to protect ourselves?
The thing that concerns me so much is this political correctness. Well, you can't offend people, and they live in Liberia, and we owe them an obligation because we started that country during the presidency of James Monroe, and therefore we owe them something. Well, we owe them to stay in Liberia if they're sick. Nobody has a right to come into the United States from a foreign country, and you're not being harsh or unkind to keep people out. If they were from Guinea, if they were from Liberia, if they're from Sierra Leone, for example, then they don't get in here. And if they get on a plane and they fly to Europe, they still don't get in here just because they came through Europe. And it's not just testing people who may be sick, it's keeping all of them out for the time being, because we don't want that stuff here. But the truth is, it's not nearly as bad as everybody says. It is a terrible disease, but it is not as rampant as everybody wants to make it seem. But it does seem, and I've said this before, we'll say it again, that virus can mutate. We don't know precisely what those viruses can do. They are enormously adaptable. And so the idea that somebody can cough, aerosol goes out, that's a bodily fluid, and people can get infected by it. So you see, it's not in the air. Well, it is airborne if somebody coughs. And it's so easy for this stuff to be transmitted, and it is a deadly disease. So let's shut it down. Let's not just say, well, only those that test sick get to stay. The rest of them can come in. No, nobody comes. Shut them down. And the people of the CDC saying, well, we can't get workers in. Yes, you can. The Air Force is just loaded with transport planes, and they can transport all the doctors in the world right into Liberia, into Monrovia, no problem. They don't have to take commercial airliners over there. Well, we'll shift gears a little bit. This onslaught of homosexual behavior that is being forced on us by the Supreme Court of the United States is having deadly consequences. I was afraid it was going to happen. It has happened now in Idaho. Ephraim has that story.
Pat, two ordained ministers in Idaho could face crippling fines and even jail time for refusing to perform same-sex weddings. Donald and Evelyn Knapp run the Hitching Post Wedding Chapel in Coeur d'Alene. City leaders told the couple a non-discrimination ordinance requires them to perform ceremonies for all couples or face legal consequences. The ordinance includes a religious exemption, but excludes all public accommodations, and the city considers a chapel, a for-profit company, a public accommodation. The couple could face a 180-day jail term and a fine of $1,000 a day, Pat.
Well, if I were that couple, I'd get ahead of the curve. Get on an airplane and leave Idaho, or get in your car and drive across the border into Montana. Get out of that state, and if need be, close your chapel down. I mean, just get out ahead of it, because this is outrageous. But I was afraid this will happen. And then the next thing you know, it'll be a church. The church is going to be forced to, you can see the Monsignor of some Catholic church being forced to perform a gay marriage. You think I'm joking? That's what's happening in Idaho. You say it's a wedding chapel. It's not a church, but nevertheless, it's a chapel, and these apparently are ministers. Well, a church is going to be forced to do things like that. I remember talking to Cardinal O'Connor in New York about Georgetown, where the school was forced by the city of Washington to provide money, resources to support a gay club in the student body, and to give them telephone, to give them printing, to give them office space, et cetera. And I said, Colonel, what would you do? And he said, just as clear, he said, I'd close the school down. Now, he's talking about Georgetown University. Cardinal O'Connor, wonderful man of God, in charge of the New York diocese. And he said, I would close it down. And I think those guys in Idaho had better get out of Dodge now before it gets any worse. Ephraim.
Pat, the youth vote has been a huge support for President Obama and the Democrats, but a national poll of America's 18 to 29-year-olds shows a major drop in enthusiasm ahead of this year's midterm elections. Caitlin Burke shows us why millennials are losing faith in politics and Washington.
President Obama won the youth vote in both 2012 and 2008. The turnout of America's youngest voters was so great that if they'd swung the other way, or even split their vote, there would be a different president sitting in office right now.
We had 22 million voter turnout. That's almost half of all those eligible to vote voted.
In 2012, the youth vote played a major role in putting President Obama back into the White House. But over the last few years, something's changed, and polls show that a majority of the millennial generation don't plan to participate in the upcoming midterm elections. The most recent poll by Harvard University's Institute of Politics reported that only 1 in 4 of the young Americans surveyed will definitely be voting this fall. Millennials say it's not that they're apathetic. In fact, they care passionately. They're just repelled by what they see in Washington, including from the Obama White House.
I sense a deception that took place in the last administration's promises to my friends and peers, my age group. I'm 25 myself. We were promised a lot of hope and change. And what we're seeing before us now is a country very different than the one that we were promised would come from this administration.
So how do politicians reach a generation turned off by politics? Howard says it's about paying attention to the issues they care about.
We are a very community-minded people. We are daughters and sons and students. And because of that, when we see our mom and our dad lose their job, or we see our grandparents not able to have the same health insurance coverage that they had before, right, now it's our issue. And now it's something that we're deeply interested in seeing how our elected officials are talking about it and what they're going to do about it.
Many millennials recognize that they're a generation that will bear and see their children bear the weight of the decisions being made now in Washington, because those actions will have consequences that will last for decades. So millennials have a message for the grown-ups on Capitol Hill. Get involved, engaged, and invested in our futures and the future of America. And right now, millennials clearly don't see that happening. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
And Pat, the youth vote is a critical block.
Well, Obama had that message. He was the Pied Piper. He was offering change. I'm going to be a uniter, not a divider. I'm going to have the most open, transparent administration in history. And it went on and on. He's broken every single promise. If you like your health care, you can keep it. If you like your doctor, you can keep him. Lies, 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 one after the other. Washington Post has those Pinocchios, and he gets 4 Pinocchios over and over again. So the millennial is pretty smart. There was another story that I saw a couple of days ago that indicated not only the millennials not going to be voting, but the black voters were key to his election and key to the election of the Democrats in Congress. And the thought was that if the black people are turned off, they just don't want to vote. If they don't show up at the election, at the polls in this particular election, it's going to be an absolute rout of the Democrat candidates for Congress, House of Representatives, and Senate. Now, if they can get that machinery geared up, then that's something else, because David Plouffe and Obama and his other team members had an incredible machine for electoral turnout. But if they don't show up, if the millennials don't show up and the black voters don't show up, the Democrats are going to go down in flames, and that's what they're terrified of. Ephraim.
Pat, soft drinks could make you age prematurely by damaging your cells. That's the finding from a study at the University of California, San Francisco. The researchers found people who drank more sugary sodas tended to have a problem in their cells. The issue, known as shorter telomeres, makes it more difficult for cells to regenerate. And so the body ages and becomes more susceptible to diseases. The net effect could mean sugary sodas are aging people prematurely, even if they don't realize it. And something tells me, Pat, that's no surprise to you.
I tell you, these things aren't surprising me, but it's just horrible to think about what we're doing. We're loading up with fats and trans fats. We're loading up with salt. We're loading up with every kind of sugar. High fructose corn syrup is in everything. And if it's not that, it's some other form of sugar. And now soft drinks, whether they're diet or not, doesn't matter. There are things in there. But the telomere is the center of the cell. And if the telomeres are being injured because of these sugary soft drinks, then that is horrible. So it means you'll get wrinkly skin. It means that you'll get heart condition. You'll have diabetes. You'll have gout. You'll have arthritic conditions. You'll have all sorts of things going on. And you'll die faster. I don't know what we can do, but we've just got to change the way we eat.
Yeah. But these things, so many of them are habit forming, and that's the hard part of it.
Well, what is it? You got to run or walk, 4 miles to get off of one Coke?
Wow. Is that what they say?
That's the amount of calories in the thing.
Well, not to mention the cell damage. I'm not sure
that walk or run
is going to do anything to help that.
But these telomeres, they're the little engines that make the cells reproduce. And the DNA, it's like a long string, and it starts getting cut, mm-hmm. and it gets shorter and shorter and shorter, and then you die. That's why melatonin is so important. Melatonin, you know, rejuvenates the telomeres.
Mm-hmm. So you know, one of the things also about the sodas is, and it's almost like false advertising with the diet sodas, because there's so much salt in them. So retain all this fluid.
Well,
you know, it's hardly helping your diet.
I don't know if this is green, yellow, black, but it's tea. And so far, they haven't indicted tea yet. So I am not drinking a Coke. I'm drinking tea.
New violence in Nigeria is casting doubt on the government's claim that Boko Haram terrorist group is ready to release more than 200 schoolgirls. Friday, Nigeria's military said the radical Islamic group agreed to a ceasefire as a first step toward fleeing the girls. But Boko Haram never confirmed the deal, and dozens of civilians have been killed in attacks since then. The government says a Boko Haram splinter group might be responsible. Last April's kidnapping of nearly 300 schoolgirls caused an international uproar. Their release could help President Goodluck Jonathan's re-election campaign. CBN Asia recently celebrated its 20-year anniversary. Some 400 partners, donors, guests, and friends came together to celebrate the occasion. For the last two decades, CBN Asia has been proclaiming Christ and transforming lives in the Philippines. Superbook is one program already making an impact. There are nearly 1 million Facebook fans, and so far, more than 34,000 children and parents have committed their lives to Jesus Christ. You can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international.